Movement in edit mode. What's up? I'm Jonathan and welcome to Maker Tales, where I'm sharing my maker journey to help you go further in yours. So don't forget to subscribe and hit that little bell icon to never miss an opportunity to keep making. This video is all about movement once again. This time we're going to cover it in edit mode. There are not many differences, but there are some crucial distinctions that we need to make between object mode and edit mode. Starting with a fresh new Blender file, let's go ahead and clear our scene up. Let's go all, delete, perfect, create our own cube because we want to be the master of the cubes, and put in one. Brilliant. Now, just for the sake, we're going to do exactly the same as we did in the previous video, and let's go ahead and set the origin point to where we know where it is. So let's go ahead, set geometry, set to 3D cursor, then let's go ahead and let's move this cube to the zero point. Brilliant. So now with that there, let's go ahead into edit mode with the cube and see how movement works there. Well, there is only one real fundamental difference within edit mode, which is there is no origin point. So how are we going to be able to do this if there is no origin point? Now I have shown you how Blender uses something completely different than the origin point when it comes to having multiple objects. And what's happening within mesh mode is nothing different than multiple objects, because you have multiple vertices, you have multiple faces, and from there, what are you going to do? Well, you're going to be using this transform pivot point menu. So let's go ahead, let's select all the top vertices here, and let's just use rotation to go through each one of these. I'm going to be using the shortcuts from now on because I introduced all of these in the first video. So rotating, you can see that it's rotating in the median point, and that is because we have median point rotation. Of course, like all of these, you can constrain it. So let's get a rotation on the Z and you can see how it's constrained. Okay, next up we have active element. Now let's go ahead and do rotation. Hold on, what's going on? We do not have an active element set right this minute. And this is Blender complaining. Okay, so how do I go about setting an active element? Well, you have to deselect and reselect one to tell it where the active element is. And then from there, as you can imagine, now if we do a rotation, that is the origin point of the rotation. So we can constrain this on the X and we can put in a 45 degrees. And there we have our rotation using that active element or the active vertex. And there we have. Okay, now let's go ahead and see what's going on. So we have individual origins. Well, individual origins doesn't really work with vertices here, but it does work with edges. So let's select two edges here on completely different origins. And let's go ahead and do a rotation. You can see how strange that is because it's rotating on their own origins. Of course, we can set this on an X. And well, you can't really rotate this edge on that X. So let's do it on the Z, and you can't really do it this way. But if we go on the Y, we're affecting them both. So that is individual origins. It's a very strange way to go ahead and edit mesh, but it is possible. Let's go back into vertex selection and let's go and check out the 3D cursor. As you can imagine, we have the 3D cursor here. We can snap it to where we want it. Let's snap it over there. And now when we do a rotation, and let's constrain it to the Z, we're using our 3D cursor as our origin point. As you can imagine, you can get some very precise movement using the combination of all of these together. Now, lastly, we have this bounding box, which in all honesty is just the whole shape of itself. So if we go rotation, it's rotating in the middle of the object. So if we were to just select one vertex here and we do a rotation, it's not going to really do anything because it needs a bounding box. And the bounding box is the shape that is created of a cube when all the things are selected. And now we do a rotation, it's going to use the middle point of all of those there. And that there, in all honesty, covers edit mode movement. Now, of course, we can select everything here and do a shift D and constrain it on the Y and pull it out. And then we can see how things work now. So if we do a rotation, the bounding boxes of the whole selection here. Okay, so what happens if we go 3D cursor? Well, it's going to be using the 3D cursor. Okay, that's nice and simple. Everything's working there. But what happens now when we go into individual origins? That's strange. Why is that individual origins? They're in the same object. Yes, they're in the same object, but they're their own selected meshes. They are loose meshes. So thus, they're going to create their own bounding box, each one, and that's going to be their origin point. Okay, so that's interesting to know. So what's going to happen then when we do our median point? Well, that's pretty much the same as the bounding box. And then we have, lastly, the active element, which, as you can see right this minute, is right there. And you can only have one active element. So with that one active, now if we do a rotation, you can see that it's moving it there. Now, do keep very aware about what I'm about to show you, which is, of course, we go here, we click on this one here to make it the active, we do a rotation on the X of 45 degrees, on the minus. Perfect, that's nice. Let's go into object mode. Look where our origin point is. All movement that is done within edit mode does not affect the origin point, and that is so important to keep in mind. This is why you need to have really good origin point and mesh control so you understand what's going on in relationship to one another. Now, lastly, let's go ahead and cover something that might melt your brain a little bit here. So let's go ahead. We have this on medium point. It doesn't really matter. But what we're moving is this origin point. So let's go do our rotation on the Z. Let's counter rotate what we've just done there, 45 degrees. Okay, so that's that done. Now we can just go ahead and hit G, hit Y, and we're moving on the global. And what happens if we hit Y again now? Wait, what? Why is that the case? Because this is the orientation of the object. Doesn't matter what the mesh is. The object has a rotation. Inside of mesh, this does not have a rotation. So keep that in mind. This local and global is talking about the local and global of the origin point here. So if we do a G now and we constrain this to the Y, you can see what's going on. And if we go Y once again, this is the local of the object. In other words, of the origin point right here. One last more complicated little bit of edit mode is I just want to show you something interesting, which is in edit mode, yes, we don't have our active object, but if we do our Control L to select all linked, we have our active element here, and these work like origin points. Origin points can do snapping. However, we have to make sure that we have this set to active elements, and our snapping, let's say we're snapping to a vertex, we're wanting to make sure is it snap with the active. Now, yes, I told you not to worry about that, but we're now at the point where we'll worry just about this one, but in the future, we'll be doing something else. But I need to show you this, because now when we hit G and we move this around, we can snap with our active element to things that we want to snap to. So just keep that one in mind. As I promised in my last video, I would show you that little bonus extra in edit mode. So let's go ahead. Let's create ourselves a UV sphere. Let's give it quite a bit here. Let's go for 64 and let's give it 30 rings or something. And now let's take this into edit mode. So with this in edit mode, let's just select that one vertex up at the top. And now let's turn on proportional editing. And now when we go ahead and do a G and constrain it on the X, we make this nice and small You can see what's happening here. Let's make it nice and big now. And there we get our proportional editing doing some crazy stuff. Now, something that's quite fun about proportional editing is this, where it's random. So if we go random, and now we do proportional editing, what's going to happen? Well, it's going to randomly move our entire mesh on this proportional editing. So as you can imagine, this is quite an interesting way to get some crazy shapes going very quickly. On top of that little bonus extra, I do want to show you one other thing of Blender. So again, not precision modeling, but it's useful to just know these things of Blender. If we have a whole bunch of objects, and let's say you wanted this to be some sort of random, I don't know, floating rocks somewhere in your architectural drawing. Well, if you want, you can select everything here, go into Object, Transform, and then there's this lovely little randomized transform. And from here, you can pick some random seeds, put in what you're wanting. So let's just chuck in some rotation randomization here, really crank that right up. And you can see just right here how it goes ahead. And just flick through these different seeds till there's one that you'd like the look of. I don't know, I quite like that one. No, I didn't. Let's find me something. Find me something random. There we go. And there you go. Random transforms. So random movement is completely possible, and it's just as easy as that. So now you know how to do random movement through proportional editing. You know all the movement that is in Blender now. Using all that together is how you can do Blender precision. But there's a much quicker way of doing it. I'm going to show you that right now. Well done for getting through this video. Yes, it's probably another bit one of a tricky one, but keep in mind that all of this is basically the hardest part of Blender, is understanding how to move things precisely from one place to the other. And next up is going to be the precision method that I primarily use. Stick to the end for a little bit extra. Thank you so much to my patrons. You guys are absolutely awesome, and it means the world to me. It really is why I can do all this. And if you're enjoying what I'm doing here and you think I'm worthy of your support, I would love to see you there too. Join the Discord community down below if you have any questions or want to share what you're learning. Thank you for watching, keep making, and let the quest continue. Down in the description is this small little obstacle course to make sure you understand what we've covered. I have gone and put in a little tricky something in there, so good luck for you. And if you need a solution, it's also down in the description.